Sorry, dogs. Careful. These vines are taking over my entire world, and I keep having to throw them back over here. This right here is supposed to be a weed. Yeah, it is. It's a thistle. And it was growing up, it was this itty-bitty thistle, and I didn't get around to mowing it. And around here, if you don't get around to something, it will come back and it will bite you. My thistles grew up, and they're actually beautiful plants. Most people don't want thistles in their yard. I really don't care. And then what happened is the wild pickles, the wild cucumbers, they grew up. Mike calls them the wild pickles, so I got to call them the wild pickles. They're this vine. And if you don't know what a wild cucumber is, look it up. It's got all the little pokey things, the little thorns that tell you not to eat it. Well, they grow everywhere on the property. And what they're doing is they're coming up the hill like a little army, and they're attacking. They're growing over the weed. So a weed is taking over a weed. And this battle is kind of taking my, let go of my shovel, you little pig. It's about ready to take over my picnic table. I need my picnic table. I don't need the rest of this property, but I do need my picnic table. And there we go. Early morning rant, sorry. I just want a little space all to myself. You know, I was, by the way, hi. Welcome back to the farm. Glad you could make it. This is compost. And I'm dehydrating it. I mentioned the compost, and I'm not featuring compost. It's just something I have to do. I got a lot of things I need to do today, and here come the chickens right over the darn fence. You see, right on the other side of my butt-ugly barbecue, that's the rooster and his little girlfriends that follow him around. Yeah, they can fly because they're still young and not fat like their parents. They can fly. When they get older, they'll fatten up and it's harder for them to fly up here. But for right now, no, they like it. And they fly over the fence because they think I have something good to eat. And they also like to perch on there. But it's not advisable because we have predators out here, and that's what I was going to mention today. If this vine takes Tanner, let me know, okay? The poor thing. I'm dehydrating compost. It's a beautiful thing. Take that big, beautiful, rich, moist pile and turn it into dry crumblies. That's what I've been doing every single day like clockwork. I used to use my dehydrator for drying fruits, vegetables, even meat. I made beef jerky on this thing, but now I've sacrificed it to compost. So this is what it turns into. Slightly, almost like a dried out brownie.
Yep.
And it's got a couple sticks in it. But this is what I'm doing every single morning. I empty out the dehydrator, and then I fill it back up with baked compost that's already done, that was baked in the oven yesterday, and I start the process over again. Then, as soon as I get this done, I can start my day. And my day starts before the sun comes up. Wow, the sun did come up, but it's behind some haze, so it's not shining in my face. One of the nice things about having this hot, humid, yet dry drought that we're going through. It's insane. You know, I heard it on the weather a few days ago that this, well, not this, but July and going into August is the second driest period for that period of time since 1937. I'm old, but I ain't 1937 old. No. So it has been bone dry. We are in the middle of a bone crushing drought. Whereas we were getting rain earlier in the season and the farmers were dancing around on the head of a pin and just loving their life and the corn was growing. Well, now when the corn ears are on the plant and they're trying to mature, no rain for the longest time. And the farmers are just dying out here. They're hoping that we get some kind of rain, but it's almost a little bit too late. And that's really kind of sad. But what it's also doing is I should take this in. It cannot stay outside because I don't want a fly or a gnat landing on it and laying an egg. This is supposed to be 100% pure. I'll be right back. Don't go nowhere. Beans. Want any beans? I got more than enough. Grab one and chew on it while I talk. Well, here I am in the food forest, and as you can see, I trimmed this down. This is the asparagus that was growing super tall with the cucumber vines all over it. Well, I yanked out the cucumber vines, threw them over the fence, chickens ate them, turned them into poop. That was really nice. And I gave all the asparagus a haircut. Cut it down so that the sun could get over here and do what it does, work its magic over by the tomato and the pepper and the cotton. Well, there's a bump in the road. With the drought comes issues with our predators, the rabbits. They're eating more greens, so they're all over the place because they got to stay hydrated. That's how the rabbits get most of their moisture, is from the greens that they eat. And we have a biblical plague of rabbits this year. So I have rabbits all over the place. Rascal cannot keep up with them. He's running around like a chicken without a head, trying to keep these rabbits out of the yard, and it just doesn't work. He runs one way, they come the other way. He comes this way, they come that way. Some of them even just kind of hop really slow, like, catch me, catch me. And they're really messing with his head. The other two dogs, they don't chase rabbits that often, just once in a blue moon. Well, he's keeping the rabbits in line. I have the chipmunks going all over the place. I have a lot of chipmunks this year because I won't kill a chipmunk. Even though they might nibble on a few things and they dig in the garden and plant some seeds, they really aren't that much of an issue. Well, I'm getting to a point here. I thought the chipmunks were coming into my garden and eating a lot of things. This, a cotton plant, beauty. Well, it was a beauty, and it was putting out all the flowers, it was looking really good, and it puts out the cotton balls, you know, the little balls of cotton, and they're going to open up and be really nice. Well, I was coming out every morning, looking at the garden, trimming up here and there, and I noticed that the cotton ball from, like, the day before, hey, littler, keep hunting, they were gone. Just stone cold gone in the middle of the night. And I thought, well, ridiculous. It's the Chippendales, the chipmunks. They're eating my cotton balls. And then on my tomato plant, I started seeing little chew marks on my tomato. And I'll show you this because, well, this is not the first one, all right? This is the second one. And this is really disturbing. And I don't like it. I don't like it. I don't like it. Hey, look, I'm a tomato head. No, look at this. Yeah, isn't that ugly? I hope you're not eating your breakfast while you're watching this. This is, well, it was a beauty of a tomato. Wasn't that nice? Yeah, it was a really nice tomato until this. Oh, tomato. Well, it'll be chicken food. That's kind of sad. Such a beautiful tomato wasted. I blamed it on the chipmunks. And then I got another one. And then yesterday, I was emptying the compost out over there by the picnic table. I just happened to look over here because, you know, I'm doing this, I don't have to pay attention. I looked over here on this little Barbie gate, the biggest, it looked like a capybara with a tail. This big, fat, stinking New York rat is hanging onto my fence on the inside, looking right over at me. And I'm looking at him, and he's looking at me, and I'm looking at him, looking at me. And I didn't know what to do, so I set the compost down. I called Rascal really quiet, picked him up, and slowly started marching with him like a gun. I was aiming him at the fence. And I kept saying, get the rat, get the rat. And he's looking all over the place for the rat. He's looking up like it would be flying or something like that. Then he saw the rat. And you can tell Rascal sees something. He tenses up and his little nub on his tail just starts wagging. He starts vibrating. And I ran over here and I got within 2 feet of this monolith before he even decided to move. He's so huge, he wasn't even scared. So I thought, well, I'll get you scared. And right as I came around the strawberries, he bolted. And I was like, oh, no, you cannot get away. I tossed my little rat trap over the fence, and Rascal took off. He's a rat chaser. He's a rat-type terrier. That's what they're bred for back in the day, is to go after little varmints. So I sent him after the varmint. And, of course, this is fenced in with this fine mesh wire, so he can't get out. He has to climb to get out. Yet Rascal is fast, so he doesn't give him time to climb out. So it sounds like a pinball machine in here. I got the rat going bang into the fence, and Rascal bang into the fence trying to dig around the weeds for him, and they're going all over the place, and I'm going around the outside of the garden trying to keep this rat from escaping, and Rascal got him twice. He pounced on him and bit him a couple times. The rat didn't bite back, but the rat just took off like, eh, you're bothering me. And the rat eventually got out of here. So now I have rat traps. I have one in my garden over here, two of them outside my garden. That rat is not going to be long for this world. I will not, and it turns out that's what it was. The rats are coming around and they're biting on the tomatoes. I've never had this problem before in my life. They are eating the tomatoes for the moisture content. And that's because of the drought. There's no moisture. There's no rain falling, so they can't get any kind of moisture. I put a bowl of water over there for the chickens. You think they just walk right on over there and get a drink. So, yeah, it's really kind of sad. The rodents are out and about. And then, ooh, I'm not done yet, but I am done in the garden. Let's go on over here so I don't have to look at my shame over here. Yeah, I could heft this at something. And what I need to heft it at is the next predator that I'm going to talk about. Oh yeah, I'm not done yet. Oh, I'm not done at all. When I do something, I do it right. And now that I have predators, I got them coming out the woodwork. I found out, and this is kind of sad, but it's part of farm life. You know, the new Tiny Tim, the little black one. Tiny Tim came up missing. Yep. Oh, let me get rid of this thing. It smells funny. Heave it. Oh, sorry. Oh yeah, scared the heck out of the rooster. Well, the chickens will eat it, so nothing's really wasted around here. Well, what happened was Tiny Tim turned up missing. I went out there to feed him, and he's no longer there. Nothing, not a feather, not a ransom note, nothing. I can figure it out. And then I'm feeding the chickens the next day. This is like last week. The next day I'm feeding the chickens, there's a dead chicken in my fenced yard. So I know it's not Big Head because she hasn't been around here, or Little Head. They haven't been around, and I thought, what is going on? So I had to go in there and retrieve the body, and I couldn't figure out what it was. I thought maybe it was that skunk. No, it's not that skunk because there's no smell around here, and there's no smell on the chicken. Yeah, I sniffed a corpse. So it's not that. I was trying to figure it out. And then Mike, my friend, Mike the dishwasher, he was going for a walk with the dogs. There's a brown and white cat over on that corner of the property living in the wood pile. Don't know if it has babies. Don't care if it has babies. It turns out the cat has been coming in here. That's the predator that took Tiny Tim. And that's one of the creatures that would take an entire small chicken and just take it back. So we have a feral cat on the property. Now, I've had cats on my property. I've had three of them so far, and they got along perfectly with my chickens. This one is not like the other ones. This one decides it would rather kill my chickens. I could get a cat food, but I don't know what to do about this, so I may have to get me a live trap and set it, catch the cat, and go find a new home for it. Either take it to a shelter, or if I catch it, maybe build a bit of a cage for it, and it would be a decent sized cage inside the chicken coop, 100% enclosed, top to bottom, made out of wire and wood, and with a little door. And this is my idea. If it isn't a rabbit or anything, I keep it in there and just start feeding it, watering it, sitting with it, talking with it, and try to get it used to being around the chickens without eating the chickens, and get it some cat food and some water, and then slowly domesticate it. That's my idea, because I don't want to have to give them to a shelter where they're just going to put them to sleep. That's ridiculous. And I don't want to meet my chickens. So I have to find this balance somewhere inside this insanity and see what I can do for this cat, because the cat's hungry. The cat's not doing this because he wants to be a butthead. He's just doing it to either feed himself or feed her babies. So I have to figure this out. The dogs are really no good at this because they can't get inside the wood pile, and they haven't found the cat yet. They haven't seen it. Cat hunts at night. That's my morning. Hold on just a second. I got to get that tomato over inside the chicken coop. I actually almost hit one of the little roosters. I'll be right back. How you doing this morning? Oh, I'm doing okay. My little wild tomato. Hi there. My little wild tiki. My little three-legged tanner. And king of the compost pile. He goes where he wants. See? My little wild tomato. I think I showed this in a previous episode. Well, I don't know what kind of a tomato it is, but you're not a tomato. You need to move a little bit, okay? Worth it. Either way. Yeah, it's putting out flowers. This is nothing remarkable. Most people are already harvesting their tomatoes, but this one was a wild one, and it's growing right next to its cousin, another member of the nightshade family, right here with the little white flowers. Yes, this is a member of the nightshade family. This is called a ground cherry. And some people grow them from seed. I grow them from nothing. They grow wild around here. They're a weed, considered a weed around here. Yes, you can eat these things. They are all over the place. They're growing right next to this tomato. Yes, it's putting out little tomatoes. I don't know whether this is baby Rapunzel or baby boxcar Willie from last year. But right next to the compost pile seems to be everybody's favorite place. And I'm purposely not tearing this all up because I want to harvest the ground cherries and also the wild cucumbers that are beating up the ground cherries. Look at this. Can you imagine if this was putting out decent fruit? You cannot stop this. It's like Iowa kudzu. This stuff goes nuts and grabs onto everything and goes over everything. And here's another example of goes over everything. Thistle, the bane of every gardener's existence. It's thorny, you can't touch it. It spreads seeds like dandelions. Look at this noose. Yeah, this is right next to the picnic table. This is a really big cluster of thistles that are trying to survive and make everybody's life a living heck. And yet, the wild pickles, look at this. They're absolutely covering it, taming the wild weeds. And they're actually kind of living together now. See, this one's about ready to bloom and put out their flowers. Thistle is very, very closely related to artichoke. Yes, it is. And right over here, I'll show you one of the flowers. See? Yep. Yeah, I'm thinking you could probably eat these. I mean, thistles aren't poisonous. I think you could probably eat these, but who would want to? You got to be really, really hungry to eat these things. Yeah, I'll be harvesting those seeds. Yep, seed bomb time. I am gathering every little weapon I possibly can from my arsenal here, and I got quite a bit. This has turned into more of a shade tree than anything. I can actually stand inside this tree. When it first started out, I stood right next to it, and it was this little tiny thing, and now it's turning into a shade tree. I like that. In the morning when the sun comes up, it shades the kitchen window, so when I go to get my cup of coffee, it doesn't blind me. Well, down here, you can see all these little things, little tiny leaves, and you might have this happen to you. Why am I standing behind the tree? You might have this happen to you during a drought season if you're having the drought. Some people on the East Coast, they're having floods, and they're laughing at me right now when I'm talking about drought because they would love to ship some of their rain over here. I wish you could. I wish you could, and it really sucks that you're having such a problem with all that rain. We're having the exact opposite problem. We are just a dust bowl out here, and the grass this time of the year for a lot of folks, and especially me, is starting to turn yellow and brown. Doesn't mean if you have a lawn, doesn't mean your lawn is dying. It just means it's going dormant, and that's what natural grass is around here. This is all natural, though it wasn't planted at all. It goes dormant, and it'll turn yellow and brown. And then when the rains come along, well, the clover keeps going and so do the dandelions, and I don't mow it. I don't keep it short. I let it grow as long as it wants to, because what that'll do is it helps shade the ground and less moisture loss. So if you're having a drought situation or a dry situation around your area, do not mow your lawn. Just let it go. If you can, if your neighbors aren't going to gripe too awful much, let it go. And then when it starts raining again, that's a peach leaf, my gentle little soul. He is. Let it go dormant. When the rains come along, it'll come right back. The roots stay alive. So don't worry about that. Now, another something on the other end of the spectrum, your fruit trees. Yes, this is one of my peach trees that I've been trying to care for. And what happens is during this period, it gets stressed and it started dropping a few leaves here and there. Doesn't seem like much, just a few leaves here and there. That's a stress reaction. So sometimes you may notice your tree's dropping a few leaves and you might panic and go, what's going on? Am I feeding it too much? Not too much? What's going on? It's just stress to the heat and the drought. These trees will need watering. So during the hot part of the season, get out there. If you have a soaker hose, use that and give it a good old-fashioned soaking out to a few feet to make sure it gets way down in there. Not just a light watering. That only waters the surface roots. And those are the ones that are going to suffer the most from this drought. You want to water it deep so that the deeper roots can grow down and out, and that will help it survive in future seasons. Since this is a young tree, it doesn't have as many deep roots as I'd like. That's why I'm giving it a nice solid soaking about maybe every third or about every third day. I give it a nice solid soaking so it can go way down there and feed those roots and keep this healthy. Since I've been doing that, not a single leaf has turned yellow and fallen off this tree. This was all previous before I started doing that. So that's what you can do. As far as your lawn, don't worry about it at all. And one final thing before I let you go, the sunchoke. Yep, they're way taller than I am. They're about maybe 8 feet tall at the tallest. And last year, we weren't having a drought, so these really got a lot taller. But I stopped watering these. I have not given these a drop of water all this year. And last year I was watering them, so they got really thick and full and they were beautiful. I show those in programs, and that was all well and good. But the thing is that if when I stopped watering them, if I didn't water them one day, I would have wilt. And that's because I was promoting the surface roots on these things. So this year I took a whole different approach. I don't water them at all. And what happened is that first they started wilting, and then they used the energy from the tubers in their roots. They used some of that energy and they put down deeper roots. And now that we've had that one whole month and one or two weeks, about 6 weeks, nothing, no rain, no nothing in this area. And these have not wilted at all. Now what's happening is some of their leaves are turning brown. They're sacrificing these leaves so that the top ones can grow. And of course the sunchoke patch is a perfect place for the rabbits to hide, but they can't hide from little R. This is the forest that is the sunchokes that's been spreading from like what, 6 or 8 plants. Now it numbers in close to 1,000 plants. Yes, they could be thicker stalked, but I just let them grow naturally. I don't prune them, I don't do anything to them. Here's the dead leaves towards the bottom. They die, they fall off, and they're eventually gonna become food for the next generation. You know, she's turned from a little princess into quite the little hunter since she's been here. She used to do absolutely nothing except sit around, and now she runs around, she barks, she spins around. Yeah, she's quite the little huntress too. Hey, Tiki. Hi. But the sunchokes, they will forfeit those lower leaves, and the upper leaves, they're not in the humidity, they're not dying. They're growing up because they're gonna have to put out flowers very soon towards the end of the summer, and that will herald the end of the growing season. When the sunchokes put out their flowers, that's the end of the season. Well, son of a gun. This is a sunflower. And no doubt it was planted by one of the birds, the wild birds around here. I feed them over there by the chickens, and they take the sunflower seeds and then they perch over here or on the tree and they eat their sunflower seeds. Well, sometimes they fall out of their mouth and they fall down here. This is not my doing. This is the peach tree that we are having such issues with. And look at it. It's going really well, but it's got a little fret. Well, it's also got a weed in here. Can't have that. I've been picking the weeds from here and not throwing them out, just laying them down, and it's adding to the mulch. I also threw in a couple buckets full in each one of these, this shield. This is a corrugated plastic, real thick and heavy, and it keeps the rabbits away because they will eat the bark off of your trees. And I dumped a couple bucket loads of compost from that pile into each one of these for the trees, and I think that's what's really helping them out. It's also helping the sunflower out. So this is not one of the giant sunflowers. It's one of the ones that the black oil sunflower seeds come from. And it won't get that big. So I'm going to let it grow right here. But look, it's growing 3 main branches coming out. And next spring, this year I'm not doing anything. I'm not jinxing this at all. I'm hoping that it'll survive the winter. So I'm keeping my fingers crossed, letting it do what it wants to do, watering it deep like I told you about the other one. And I got 3 main branches here. So next spring, if they come back, and I'm hoping that they do, so keep your fingers crossed for me, I'm gonna train them with lines, with soft cloth around there and string to bring these ones out like this, and this one's out towards you into a pattern, a triangle pattern, and then it can start growing up and keep the center empty for airflow and also for new stuff to grow in. So that's my plan for this little peach tree. It's doing pretty good. It's doing really well. But during the drought, it's especially susceptible because it was stressed out this early spring. So I'm keeping it watered and I'm keeping an eye on it. I like the years where there's a little bit more rain than there is this year. But even with a drought, we can still make things green and keep them growing. So make sure that you keep an eye out on your garden, okay? Because it does need a little extra care. You might think that trees don't really need care, but they do. They do. Even the big Honeycrisp. Next year, I'm gonna run a hose out there and keep it watered during the summer if we have dry periods. That means I'm gonna have bigger, juicier apples, and the tree will not be quite as stressed. So the apples will be a lot more healthy, and so will the leaves on the tree. I'll show you the Honeycrisp coming up. But for right now, I think I've pretty much talked your ear off. I think I've done that. So anyway, thank you for joining me. If you have any questions, post it in the comment section below. Otherwise, Wednesday, story time next week. Next week on Sunday, we're going to have another gardening episode, and I think things are starting to ripen, and I want to show you those. So tune in then, will you? All right, I got to get going. Hey, Rascal, come on over here. Show yourself. Yeah, you got people that need to see you. Yeah. We'll see you next week. Have a great day, everybody. Ready to go? Yeah. Shake it off, little one.